Okay, so our next speaker is Dr. Tom van den Kerkhove from Janssen in Beersa in Belgium. So Tom has a PhD from the University of Antwerp in analytical chemistry using NIR and Raman for cryospectroscopy. And he moved to J&J nearly 10 years ago to work on various spectroscopy applications, including the introduction of NIR for ID of clinical trial samples. His current interests include switching towards continuous manufacturing as a means to produce Janssen's drug products. So please, can you welcome Tom to the stage?
Okay. Thank you, Darren, for the introduction. Okay, it works. That's also good. First of all, what I've seen before lunch and what you will see in this presentation is that most pharmaceutical companies all work on the same things. And therefore, you can maybe see this is more like a repetition of what you have already seen, but I hope that I can also give a few specifics within the talk. So it's a bit different than what I put here on the title that I had when we were putting the program together. So I thought, why not focus a little bit on more of the strategy and the approach that we use within J&J. First, I want to tell you that I'm working in new analytical technologies, so in a group where we are constantly searching for new techniques in order to improve our lab efficiency of the QC laboratory. So my focus is really on being on spectroscopy, of course, but next to spectroscopy, you all know that HPLC has been replaced by UPLC, etc., etc. So that is our group doing, is looking how to increase the lab efficiency to reduce cost and improve our safety. Just to give you an idea, in 2004 we started with NIR, as Darren mentioned, for using it for identification of double-blind clinical trial samples. And then as we progressed, we started using NIR for content uniformity, API concentrations. And since 2012, we purchased the transmission Raman system. Now, when you look at it and you look at your typical release tests that need to be done, there were a lot of things that we are known how to do from the past. And you can see that a lot of things, they can be replaced by a spectroscopy method, either a Raman or NIR system. Sometimes for water content, we focus only on NIR, of course. What you immediately notice is that chromatographic purity at the moment, HPLC is the only technique that we see is capable of doing that. So there are a lot of possibilities to introduce your NIR and to get and Raman to get benefits from it. So, as mentioned, we already had NIR, and NIR is widely spread over the different GSC sites, meaning operations, quality control laboratories. Why should we then still do transmission Raman spectroscopy? So we kind of made in 2012 a business case where we would focus mainly on content uniformity and polymorphic content determination. And when we did the business case, we really compared it with NIR. And one of the major things that we got back from our QC laboratory is that in comparison with NIR, you get a less labor consuming. You can use the trays. And you have to imagine NIR as we use it, we don't have any automation at all. It means if we have to do like 60 tablets with NIR, it means an operator has to take one tablet, put it in a holder, put it on the NIR. Remove it from the NIR, put the next tablet in the holder, etc. So that is from our quality control laboratories was a big feedback that we should automate. Next to that, more selective peaks. I think this has already been discussed in previous presentations. Larger spot size also. But one important thing is we see this that we can use instead of the NIR, which is an absorption technique, that you can use it more for thick tablets, and that you could also use it for coatings and to use it for capsules. With capsules, we have with NIR a lot of problems, especially when you have the common red or dark red capsules. So also, of course, and already discussed in previous presentations, is that we see Raman, although you have a selective peak, we still see it as a secondary technique. So we need to do some meta development. So during method development can be time consuming because the same samples will be analyzed by both techniques, by the Raman or by HPLC. And like discussed previously, we would determine the concentration of the relevant parameter via reference techniques. We got here a Raman spectrum and we are just looking for the link. Well, how is the spectral variability in your Raman spectrum correlated with the variability of your concentration, for example? So also here, nothing new. Every company works the same way. Is how do we start? Again, we do a feasibility. We take a small set of samples. We do Raman analysis. And during that feasibility, also here, we select what are the acquisition parameters. And we do it almost exactly the same as was presented by the first speaker today. Method development, same way, we make some calibration samples. We do Raman analysis, we do HPLC. We build a chemometrical calibration model. And then we come to validation. One thing that we always try to do with validation is to use an independent set. So when we use calibration samples, when you use a certain batch of raw materials, etc., we make those tablets. When we go to validation, we take another batch of raw materials and make again validation samples. Do the Raman analysis, etc. We verify our chemometric calibration model. If it passes, then we start into the routine analysis. Okay. So the first example that we are focusing on is, of course, content uniformity. How much API is in your tablet? And therefore, we did some work and some investigation. What would be the benefit when using a spectroscopic technique? When we look at it, and this is our, of course, very general numbers, because there are HPLC methods which are faster, there are HPLC methods that take a longer time, etc. But in general, we say an HPLC, really the time that one person is busy with it, and with data review, everything included, is approximately 6 to 12 hours. And you can have a throughput time of two different days. When you look at Raman or another spectroscopic technique, you notice that it's a lot of that the benefit is extremely. So why Raman? Also here, you can work on the finished and the coated tablet. While with the NIR, we can only use core tablets because most coatings, they contain iron oxide or titanium dioxide, and that is not so good when doing NIR. Okay, as already mentioned, there are some differences between the reference technique, HPLC, and your Raman technique. And one of the major differences which you have to take into account when you are developing your model or when you are using your Raman method is the way that you obtain your result. With HPLC, you're going to dissolve your tablet and you are determining the absolute API concentration. With Raman, you have a direct measurement of the tablet. In other words, you are measuring a relative API concentration. If we translate these absolute and relative concentrations to pharmaceutics, then in general you could say absolute API concentration is generally expressed as a content uniformity result, while a relative concentration is an assay result. So when you are developing it and you take HPLC as a reference method, in order to set the correct reference values, you have to make sure, okay, my Raman, I have assay results, so I have to convert this content uniformity result into an assay result, and you can do that by the tablet weight. Also vice versa, when I'm doing a Raman spectroscopy to do content uniformity analysis, my result of each tablet will be an assay. Of course, for a content uniformity analysis, I'm not interested in the assay, so therefore I have to convert this value to a content uniformity value. And I know it's already been discussed, etc., and that you can see an awful lot of the tablets so that you don't have subsampling. We still notice that with very large tablets that you can still have some subsampling with Raman, but as discussed by Andrew, what you can do then is take multiple parts of your tablet can then be measured by Raman as you are not working non-destructive. So important was, of course, the representative samples that need to be, that you need to have is with HPLC, as everyone knows, it is very easy because you are in solution, so you can easily change the concentrations to the range that you will have. If you use spectroscopy where you have a direct measurement of the tablet, you have to make them yourself. And of course, this makes that your development becomes more time consuming because you have to make them. And what we that's the wrong presentation. I see now. this is here an error. Tablets must be similar to production tablets towards dimension, hardness, and density. So what we are doing is when we are making these calibration tablets, we try to mimic as much as possible the different physical characteristics of our final commercial tablets. When we do validation, as mentioned previously, we follow the ICH guidelines, which is, in my opinion, more written for HPLC, but anyhow, we have to follow that one. So what we are doing, there are two main things that we are assessing. It's the precision, of course, which is very simple. You just do multiple Raman measurements of exactly the same sample. On the other hand, you have to do accuracy, linearity, and robustness. And robustness, we find an important one. And for these ones, you just make sure that the same tablets or the same samples are measured by your Raman and your reference method. And the robustness is what I think almost everyone does. We assess it during method development. So let's take a look at robustness. If you look at your content uniformity, you have your samples. And in our samples, we have something what we call the relevant variation. We are interested in the API concentration. Of course, in the samples, you have also non-relevant variations. It was a different particle size of the granulate used, or when you are measuring, you had a different operator or a different instrument was used. So when you look at your measurements and into your samples, you can really divide the variation into relevant and non-relevant variation. And what you want to do with robustness is to ensure that the spectral variation that we see, that it's only linked to the relevant parameter and not to the non-relevant parameter. So you must make sure that your spectral variation has no correlation with the spectral variation due to the non-relevant parameters. And by doing this, when do we do this? We do this during method development. During method development, we try to mimic our tables that we are using as much as possible as to the variations that we can expect during commercial processing. As already mentioned, hardness is one of them. We usually set a specification on the hardness. It's an in-process test and it needs to be within a certain amount. Therefore, what we're doing during development, we are going to make sure that we make tablets that have those different levels of hardness. Another one that we generally do is moisture content, although for Raman less relevant. We also verify most tablets you would have a specification moisture content must be lower than 4%. Then we make sure that in our calibration model there are tablets that contain almost no water and tablets that contain water close to the specification limit. So that's one part where we do robustness. The other part where we assess robustness is the method transfer. With method transfer, what we actually want to do with method transfer is to make sure that the model that we have developed on instrument number one can also be used on instrument number two. So we are really seeing if the method is robust to a different instrument and of course also to a different operator, but it's pretty hard to make mistakes with these kind of methods. And then next to transfer, what we also do is every period, we do something what we call method maintenance. And that means is if there is something in the sample variation which we did not cover during development or in the instrument variation or measurement variation, which was not covered in development and in method transfer, we would find them out in our method maintenance procedure. And the method maintenance, I can elaborate a little bit on that. There are two ways that we do that triggers method maintenance. First of all, we do a spectral quality test as described in the first presentation where you have Q residuals versus Hotelling T squared. If for a commercial batch, we would not follow, we would not meet the acceptance criteria on our spectral quality test, then we would automatically go to method maintenance. And another thing is next to that one, a triggered method maintenance, we do also a periodically one so that at least one time per year we have verified it. So that are the different ways to do a robustness assessment. So let's now talk about content uniformity. We have the first case study. Some results is that we have several film-coated tablets. So we have, from the same product, we have two APIs in it. It's a dual-layer product. And we know that API 2 layer has a debossing while the other API layer is nicely flat. And you can see we have film-coated tablets, and what you see here is that you have different colors. You go from orange to brown and pink. And one of the things is, when we develop a method here for these products, we cannot measure with NIR. So NIR was not an option here in order to build your content uniformity method for. So we need to go to Raman. And to Raman, what I have done here is I have put here in black the spectrum of a core tablet without a film coat and a spectrum of the film coated tablet. And what you notice is that for A, B, and D, those spectra of the film coated spectrum and of the core tablet, they are almost exactly the same. There is a little bit baseline shift, but if you do normalization, you will notice that they are exactly the same. Only one thing, and that is the red to brown one, therefore we were not, you can see a big difference in intensity, and therefore we were not able to make a Raman method on the film coated tablets. So, as I mentioned previously, Raman you can use for film coated tablets. Also there are some limitations, but in our experience is that for 90% of the film coats that we use, you can use Raman transmission. Also here, it's a bilayer tablet where you can see that API 1 has a, is a thin layer, is a low concentration product, while API 2 is in a thick layer, which is a very high concentration of the product. And then we noticed rather quickly that the positioning of your tablet is very important. You see here the laser versus the detector. Whether your API layer 1 is located towards the detector or your API layer is located towards your laser makes a big difference in your spectrum. This is the spectrum. The blue one is with the API layer towards the detector, while the red one is to the API layer towards the laser. And as you notice here, if you look at it, there is a very big difference in intensity. So, but of course, we can easily do that. Now we have just described in the test method, the API layer number 2 has an embossing, the other layer has no embossing. Just put the tablet always in the correct way in your sample tray, and that problem is overcome. Just want to give you some idea of what is what are the results that we had for when we make such a model, and how did it compare with NIR. So at the top, you notice it's the NIR results of method validation, while at the bottom, it are the Raman results of method validation. And we had some very curious results, was that for API 1, which is the concentration of the drug is really low, it's around 2 to 3% in weight. You notice that we have a better Raman result as compared to NIR. If you look at NIR, you have an average error of around 3.5, while with Raman it's 2.3. And then something strange is, when we compare actually for API number 2, which is the highly concentrated drug in it, we notice that the NIR has a better result as compared to the Raman. Okay, how do we work now for content uniformity in routine ways? How would we do? How would we tackle that? We would do exactly the same as for HPLC. We would take 10 tablets, And each tablet we would measure with a Raman, so each tablet gives a spectrum. From that spectrum, because there are two APIs in it, we get an assay result from each tablet. Now, just what you see here is that there are the assay, you see three assay results of one spectrum. That is of three assay results for the first tablet. That is because here we already changed our strategy and we were measuring the tablets at three positions. Position one, center, and right, so three positions. And we take the average from them. Next to that, there are two ways in order to proceed. Depends a bit about your strategy. Either you say, I have my 10 tablets, and the average result that I have for those 10 tablets, that is nice. This is my assay of my batch. That's a strategy to do it. Or you can say, I'm only using this for content uniformity, and I can build in already kind of a control test. And that is what we call a correction factor, where we know that from this particular batch, we still have an HPLC analysis to perform assay and impurity, so you can calculate what we call a correction factor. And then dependent on that correction factor, what the result is, you can either say, I use my Raman method, or I don't use my Raman method. Oh, sorry. If I use my Raman method, then I would go the 10 tablets I would weigh, I would convert the assay to a content uniformity. If needed, I can even apply the correction factor on the results, and then I can calculate my result itself and look how good this batch was. So this is kind of the approach that you can do if you would use it only for content uniformity. If you would use it for assay, you would skip this last step here, and you would take here, you would obtain the assay results, and here you would obtain the content uniformity results. Okay, that's the first application where we have been focusing on. Then the second application came last year, all of a sudden a burning topic. We had to do polymorphic content determinations. And as mentioned also by Holger, the best way to do it is actually the nominal. I written here that you can take reference values also for the XRD, but as most people know with XRD, in order to get a nice quantitative model, it's not very common. Most of the time your XRD is a pass-fail test in general. Some of the things that we noticed is you need to have, again, representative samples, so powders and tablets. You need to have the containing the polymorph of interest in the desired range, and the tablets must be similar to your production tablets. Also, there we were struggling with powders in order you spike your samples in order to get nice homogeneous blends for it. Okay, this is exactly the same as for content uniformity, so I'm going to skip of that. So let me already tell you the next example is, we have tablets, these two types of tablets. We have one API in the tablet, and we have two different formulations, which are not dose proportional. Therefore, we need to have a good quantitative technique in order to determine one API. One polymorphic form, and we called it form B. I can unfortunately not say what the actual name is, but we called it form B, and that form must definitely be not present as low as possible as we can detect, and the other one is form A. Now, you have to think about it. We need to check all our tablets, and the tablets are produced at two different locations in the world, and when we started developing, we used solid-state NMR in order to see how low that we could detect these ones. Of course, solid-state NMR is not a technique that they can easily use into the quality control lab. So therefore, there were only two possibilities. Let's find out what we can do with spectroscopy. And we can either use reflection NIR, we can use transmission NIR, and we can use transmission Raman. And we came to the conclusion that transmission Raman was the best way to proceed. Transmission NIR was almost immediately deleted because the API peaks of interest from both forms are not in the range that you can measure with transmission NIR. But then still you could do reflection NIR, and I will come back on that later. But I first want to show you the spectra. The difference in the spectra between a tablet, which has 100% of the API in the tablet is form A, and a tablet where 100% of the API is form B. And therefore, you can see several differences already in the low wave number region, and you can see differences here. We selected to use this particular region between 600 and 950 centimeters minus one because we have a nicely isolated specific band due to form B. And also here, if you would zoom in, you would see also many differences. So our calibration model we built on based on that particular region. And just to show you how good that the calibration model is, we use the reference values reference values out that we made the tablets. And then you notice that when you look at it, we had approximately an error of 0.3% for a range between 0 and 7.5%. So we think that is acceptable and a good Raman method. Now, therefore, we had, at the time that we started, we had two methods. We had the transmission Raman and we had also the NIR reflection on it. And we did some stability studies. And yeah, this is just a stability number. And we used tablets where we put up in front. These tablets contain 5% of our polymorphic form B. We tested them with NIR. With NIR, it was a reflection, and we just defined the NIR as a pass-fail test with a limit of detection of 3%. We tested them at the zero time point, and we saw it's form B. We tested them after 3 months, and then we had two different conditions. Were stored in 25-60%, 40-75%. And then we saw something very strange is that in this condition, the NIR could not detect form B, while in this condition, the NIR could detect form B. If you really look at the Raman, which is a quantitative method, you can notice that we have 5%, 4.5%, 5%. And just to show you what the difference here, the red spectrum is the form B, 0% of form B. The pink one was a sample spiked with 8% of form B, while the black one is the sample, this particular sample over here. And you can clearly see that the specific band of form B is present already visually in your Raman spectrum. So what happens now with the NIR? And there we come into the problem of the subsampling. The NIR reflection, it just measures, you have your tablet, it measures this part of the tablet, the surface, you turn it around, and you measure that part of the tablet. So we notice that NIR, no form B detected. Raman, we did form B detected, so we were already thinking, okay, NIR might be subsampling, why don't we see it for the others? So what we have done is, we have cut the tablet in two halves. In the half that was cut, we did some Raman imaging, and we could clearly see that for these particular tablets, all your form B was either migrated or maybe already from the initial phase at the center of your tablet and not nicely uniformly spread over your entire tablet volume. So that is a big benefit of Raman, that you don't have these subsampling effects. Okay, as mentioned previously, we are now getting almost in the phase that we need to transfer these methods from our R&D facility to our quality control labs. So therefore, we need to do transfer. As I mentioned, it transfer has actually two things. You need to prove that the receiving laboratory is capable to execute the test method. Now, let's be honest, who wouldn't be able to put a tablet in a tablet holder, put it in the instrument and press play? So that is very logical. Everyone can do that. But then, of course, another thing that you have to make sure is that you develop a method on one model, on one instrument, sorry, and you may have to make sure that when you apply this method on a different instrument, you have to make sure that you obtain equivalent results for it. So, and that is the main reason why we do transfer with Raman spectroscopy. So well, therefore, we already state that the Raman test method can only be applied on Raman instruments either used during the development and the validation of the test method, or for which a transfer has been executed. How do we do transfer? There are two ways to do transfer, where the first one is the one that we prefer, is parallel testing. That means that we are going to analyze exactly the same samples by the Raman test method at the transferring site and at the receiving site. In other words, on a Raman instrument for which was used during development, and a new Raman instrument. That is what we are doing. Now, as mentioned by Andrew, in 2012, when we started with this technology, we did not hear yet about a green glass standard. So that is something that is the last year has been into place. And the method that we developed was without the green glass standard. So we had some conversation with Darren and with Andrew, and therefore we decided, okay, let's do our measurements. We have a calibration model, we have a set of samples, and let's do our measurements with the green glass and without the green glass, and look at the results what we have obtained. So we have done that for case study number two, where we were looking at form B in form A. Now, the next slide is maybe a little bit overwhelming, but if you look at these slides, these are the true values. These are the nominal values that we obtain. And when you look at it, we measured those tablets in Janssen. We measured it without the green glass, exactly the way as the method was developed. And we measured it with the green glass spectrum. Then we sent those tablets to Cobalt, and in Cobalt did exactly the same. They measured the tablets without the green glass and with the green glass. And an interesting result that we had is from each of this concentration level, we had a total of 10 tablets measured. When you look then, if you look and you apply the calibration model to it, when you look actually to the standard deviation that you obtain for the 10 tablets, there is really no statistical difference whether it was measured at Janssen or at Cobalt, whether it was measured with the SRM or without the green glass. So the variation that you see is exactly the same at all the different situations that we occurred. But what do we see here? And that's maybe here a little bit more elaborated. This is the difference in prediction values. If we look at Janssen and we look at the predicted values between without and with the green glass, we notice that they are stable over the entire range, and it's always a bias of approximately 1.5, 1.6. The same way when you look at it at Cobalt, where they did no and with, also again a bias a little bit less. When you look at Janssen versus Cobalt without the green glass, you notice that there is systematic a small bias of 0.2 percentage between the Janssen instrument and the Cobalt instrument. And you see almost exactly the same when using the green glass. So in conclusion here is what I think, and you can correct me of course, is that for this particular model, we are rather robust and we can easily state that there is indeed a small difference between the instruments, but that the instruments is minimal, it's less than the error. And that in future, in order to use it on a different instrument, because it's the same for the different concentrations, that we could do a bias correction only. Okay, what is the current situation and what do we want to do in the future with the transmission Raman? Currently, because we are in R&D facility, we had some problems with the instrument qualification. It's ongoing, meaning that we had some problems with the 21 part 11, etc. And also here, it's to just to mention it, all the spectra that you've seen, all the things that were collected, we always did a daily control test. We always checked that the instrument from an analytical point of view was correctly working. So we are, by the end of the year, the instrument qualification should be finished. What we noticed here is we have now 3 years of experience is we do the daily checks. When you do the daily checks, we actually check two types of standards. We check the Teflon standard and we check the polystyrene standard. What we noticed is that the criteria set by cobalt was plus minus 1 centimeter minus one. When we noticed that we were not always able to obtain this criteria. But then when looking at the European Pharmacopoeia, which will be active next year, second quarter, you notice that they actually allow a bigger acceptance criteria of 1.5%. Going back to our data, we are always within the 1.5%. So we don't foresee any problem there. Also maybe good to give with you is that instrument maintenance, we find is very important to do every year. Because what we notice is when the maintenance has been done and they have calibrated our instrument again with, I believe it's a mercury lamp, that at start you see that the differences are very close to zero always, but the longer that you wait, that they start deviating a little bit more. Okay, what do we want to do with it in the future? So we are now in a state that we have almost a qualified instrument within R&D. We are going to purchase Raman for our GSC sites. That means that the two methods that you have seen previously, we are going to transfer to the GSC site. For one of the methods, which is the content uniformity, we see a bigger bias and we need to discuss with Andrew. And also, when we are now doing new product development or new products, we are always going to do a feasibility. And with the feasibility study, we are going to evaluate which technique that we will continue, NIR or Raman. But because of the benefits of Raman, our preference within the R&D operation is always to focus on Raman. And only if Raman will not be able to get to the result, that then we would switch as a backup solution to NIR. Okay, so therefore, just want to thank two of my colleagues who have been working on that one, Anna and Anna-Leen, and I want to thank you for your attention.